Bismillah, alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Allahumma alimna ma yinfa'una wa anfa'na bima allamtana wa zidna ilman ya arhamar rahimin. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach us what benefit us. Benefit us from what you taught us and increase us in knowledge. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. Inshallah ta'ala, today is our second lecture in the series of epic legends. We discussed last week Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu ardah, and we said that he was called the fifth Khalifa. Just a reminder that this whole series is an attempt. It's an attempt to reconnect the Muslims of the 21st century with their past, with the glamorous history that we have, so we can feel shy about our negligence towards this deen and feel shy about wasting time. This is how these great characters took care of every single second. And that's why we are remembering them 1,000, 1,200, 800 years after. So inshallah ta'ala, when we come and listen to these lectures, please make the intention that hopefully we will go home. If our kids are not with us, we will teach them these great legends in our history, and with the intention to imitate them, emulate them, and take something from their biography and implement it in our life, inshallah. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, one of our great giants, ulama, he said about our hero for today, he said, when I would reach my wits, when I reach my wits' end, yani when I can't think anymore regarding any issue of Islamic knowledge, I would go to Sufyan and ask him. And it would be as if I am scooping from an ocean of knowledge. To appreciate this more, you have to know who's Abdullah ibn Mubarak. He is one of the greatest scholars in Islam. He is saying this about our hero today. Ibn Uyayna, he said, I never saw anyone more knowledgeable in the halal and the haram than Sufyan Al-Thawri. Imam Al-Awza'i, rahimahullah, he said, if I were asked to choose someone to lead this ummah, the only choice I have is Sufyan Al-Thawri. Imam Al-Awza'i. They call him the fifth Imam. Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, Ahmad, and then the Awza'i. And as a matter of fact, there are six madahib. There are more madahib, but the ones we know are four. The ones that are cherished by their students are four. Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad. But there are two very famous ulama also, which are Imam Al-Awza'i and Imam Sufyan Al-Thawri. But unfortunately, their students did not register and continue their knowledge, like the other a'imma. Listen to what Imam Ahmad himself, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, what did he say about Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah? He said, do you know who is the Imam in my heart? Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said, do you know who is the Imam in my heart? The Imam in my view is Sufyan al-Thawri. No one comes before him in my heart. So our hero for today, our legend for today, is none but the giant, the legend, Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan al-Thawri. Subhanallah, ya akhwan. Wallahi, I'm so glad that you are attending, because it's so important to learn our history. One time I was in a masjid, just to show you the ignorance and how ignorance could lead to insult. I was in a masjid, and a man brought up the story of Sufyan al-Thawri, brought up his name. And he said, Let me tell you a story why his name is Sufyan Al-Thawri. Why his name is Thawri. Thawri, Thawr, Thawr in Arabic is? Bull. So the people in the masjid, just like you, he said, why was his name Sufyan Al-Thawri? He said, because one time, this is to show you, that not everybody could get up and start talking without knowledge. He said, because one time he walked into the masjid with his left foot. So his teacher told him, Ya Thawr, get out of the masjid. From that day, everybody calls him Sufyan Al-Thawri. Tayyib. How could you, as a man supposedly with knowledge, believe something like this? What kind? If Sufyan Al-Thawri is in this level, can you imagine his teacher? Would a teacher of knowledge tell his student, Ya Thawr? What kind of teacher is this? And what did he do? What is the crime that he did? He entered the masjid with the left foot, yani? Thawr, Qabila Thawr, is a major qabila, major tribe in Kufa, in Iraq. And this is where Sufyan is from. He's from Qabila Thawr. So his original name is Sufyan bin Sa'id bin Masruq al-Thawri. Sufyan bin Sa'id bin Masruq al-Thawri. He was given some titles that not too many people were given. He was given by Imam al-Dhahabi. We all know Imam al-Dhahabi, the author of Sir al-Nubala. He had a whole series about all these legends. And he wrote about Sufyan al-Thawri in abundance. He said, هو شيخ الإسلام إمام الحفاظ سيد العلماء العاملين في زمانه أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. Sufyan al-Thawri. He was given those titles, شيخ الإسلام. And by the way, these titles, we do not give it to people. These are ulama, give these titles to each other. شيخ الإسلام, إمام الحفاظ, إمام of the حفاظ, the chief of all practicing scholars of his time, and أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. يعني he was a major scholar in Islam and a major figure that should be learned about and taught to our children. He was born in Kufa during the Khilafah of Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, and he was born in the year 97 Hijri. Imam Abu Hanifa, I think it was 80 something, right? So he was very close to Imam Abu Hanifa at that time. And he died in the year 161 after Hijrah. So he lived around 64 years, not too old. His father himself, Sa'id, is a scholar. Ya akhwan, subhanallah. His father is a scholar himself. And he was a scholar of hadith also. His brother was a scholar of hadith. And his mother, my sisters, if you are here, listen to this mother. His mother had a very famous quote. She told her son, Sufyan, go and learn the hadith and I will support you. I will support you with my spinning wheel. Yani, I will spin and sell whatever I spin and support your education and go seek the knowledge of the hadith. But when you have written down, listen to the mother, subhanallah, when you have written down 10 ahadith, look and see. If you notice improvement in the way you walk, in the way you talk, in the way your level of patience and your degree of self-dignity, then you move to another 10. Otherwise, my son, know that the knowledge will harm you more than it will benefit you. Now, we have people memorizing the whole Bukhari, the whole Muslim, and he's a liar. He cheats. The whole Quran. Ya akhwan, the ilm without amal, al-ilm, لَقَدْ هَتَفَ الْعِلْمُ بِالْعَمَلِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَأْتِي وَإِلَّا ارْتَحَلْ. The ilm called the amal, yelled after the amal, come. If the amal does not come, the ilm will go. And many, many people who just learned to show off or to be called Sheikh or Imam or Ustaz or this and that, that was the worst thing in their life. It ruined them. And they became worse than before the deen. So if you are not intending to learn this deen, to practice it and get closer to Allah and teach it to others, don't go there. Don't go there. This is what the advice of the mother of Sufyan to her son. He wrote a few books, Al-Jami' Al-Kabir and Al-Jami' Al-Saghir. Some of his teachers are Sa'id, his father, Hisham ibn Urwa, Al-Aswad ibn Qais, Abu Hazim ibn Dinar, Wa'ikrama ibn Ammar. He, Sufyan, has a phenomenal memory. He sits in a class with his teacher. He does not have to have a book or anything to write down. Whatever they say, he memorizes. 2, 3, 5, 10, 15 pages, done, word by word. He said himself, listen to what he said, whatever my ears have heard, I have memorized. To the level, if I pass by someone singing, I close my ears so I won't memorize the song. This is how strong is his memory. If he passed by somebody singing, he will close his ears in order not to memorize the song. This is how strong was his memory. Al-Ashja'i, rahimahullah, he said, I personally heard 30,000 hadith from Sufyan. 30,000 hadith from Sufyan. We all know that some hadith narrated, sometimes one word is different, that's considered another hadith. You know, different narration, different person narrating it. Listen to the advice he gave his students. He said, the first stage of knowledge is silence. Listen, silence. The second is memorizing. And the third is applying what you learned. And the fourth is teaching. Abdurrahman al-Razi, he said, a man came to Sufyan seeking knowledge. The first question he asked, subhanallah, do you have any support? You want to come and sit with me 7-8 hours to learn the deen? Do you have any income? Where are you going to get? Where are you going to live from? If he has no income, no support, go. He used to insist on having a source of living, a source of income before you come and learn the knowledge. He hated to ask anybody for money. And he said, if it wasn't for money, then the kings will use us as handkerchiefs. لَتَمَنْدَلَ بِنَ الْمُلُوكِ لَتَمَنْدَلَ مِنْ مَنْدِيلِ يعني لَتَمَنْدَلَ بِنَ الْمُلُوكِ. If it wasn't for the money. So he was a tajir, he was a merchant, and at the same time, he was this scholar. He was asked one time, would somebody have money be considered a zahid? You know, because we know the zuhd is to divorce this dunya and don't get involved with any money and all that. He said, can somebody be zahid and has a lot of money? He said, yes. He said, how? He said, if إذا أعطي شكر وإذا حرم صبر. If when he is given, he's grateful, and if he was deprived, he's patient, then doesn't matter. Subhanallah. إذا أعطي شكر وإذا حرم صبر. Beside, he was a alim in hadith and a alim in fiqh. He was also known, if you look in the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, you will see him quoting him many times. He was also a mufassir. One of the beautiful, I picked only three tafsir of his tafsir. He said, when he was asked, what does it mean, سَنَسْتَدْرِجُهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ in Surah Al-Qalam. سَنَسْتَدْرِجُهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. What does it mean? He said, subhanallah, he said, we will give them so many ni'am and we will deprive them from being grateful. Very deep. He said, we will give them so many ni'am, because sometimes people think, if I have one business and I have 10 businesses after that, that means Allah loves me. Even though he's not praying, he does not give his zakat, he doesn't do anything, he will tell you, brother, if Allah does not love me, he would have not given me 7 more stores. He would not make me a doctor. He would not make... No, 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 no. There's nothing to do with it. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could give you and see what you're going to do. So he said, but tafsir of this ayah, سَنَسْتَدْرِجُهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. They will be giving so many blessings, but they will be deprived from the ni'mah of the shukr. And when he was asked, what does خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, that mankind is created weak, what does it mean? He said, he gave a beautiful example. He said, a woman walks by a man, and he cannot even control his gaze. What do you want weaker than that? He said, a woman passes by a man and he does not even lower his gaze. What do you want weaker than that? خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. And when he was asked, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ, what does it mean in Surah Al-Hadid? And Allah is with you wherever you are. He said, he's with you with his knowledge. He's with you with his knowledge. That was the opinion of Sufyan Al-Thawri, rahimahullah. Listen to his manners. He said, if I wanted to drink water, and a person get me the water before I go and get it to myself, I feel that I will never be able to repay him this favor. Only if he had them a cup of water. I said, I feel like I will never be able to repay this person this favor. He once, listen to the akhlaq of the ulama, ya akhwan. He once visited the Imam al-Awza'i, rahimahumullah, and throughout the meeting, both of them had their head bowed down out of respect to one another. Both of them are looking like this, you know, out of respect to one another. Subhanallah. His worship. Ibn Wahab, he said, rahimahullah, I saw Sufyan making sujood of sunnah till maghrib, and he did not raise his head till the adhan of Isha. The sunnah that we did after maghrib, we make our sujood, ya akhwan, so quick, very fast, as if we are allergic to the carpet. Huh? Take your time in your sujood, ya akhi. One of the ulama, he said, I saw Sufyan around the Kaaba. He was making sujood. I was making tawaf. I finished the first round, second round, third round, seventh round. And in Arabic, they call every seventh round, they call it usbu', just like week in Arabic. So I did sab'a asabi' wa ma zala Sufyan fi sujood. So he did 49 tawaf and Sufyan is still making sujood. This is what kind of man we are talking about. He lived, Sufyan, rahimahullah, he lived most of his life in hiding from the Khalifa, because he witnessed some of the Umayyad and some of the Abbasi. Running away from what? Do you know why? He was running away from them because they wanted to give him the job of Qadi al-Qudat, the judge, yani supreme judge. And he's running away because he doesn't want that job. So he went to Abu Ja'far, he was the Khalifa who gave him very hard time. He asked him many times, he doesn't come. Then one time he came to him. And when he came to his majlis, Sufyan, rahimahullah, he looked at Abu Ja'far and said, I know of a man, if he's righteous, the whole ummah will be righteous. So Abu Ja'far said, who's that? He said, you. So Abu Ja'far controlled himself. Then Al-Mahdi, the Khalifa after him, he took his ring and threw it to Sufyan and he said, ya Sufyan, we want you to be our qadi, our judge, and we want you to rule with the kitab and sunnah. So he said, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, do you give me the aman to speak? Can I speak? Can I talk? He said, yes. He said, please don't send for me again. If I want to visit you, I will come myself. And he left. So the people told him, he's telling you rule with the kitab and sunnah. He's not telling you do anything wrong. He said, subhanallah. He said, you know, when my income is depending on them, I'm so afraid and worried that I see the evil and I will not say anything anymore. So forget about that job. And he lived all his life. And I want you to please go back. This is very brief. His seerah is books. Read his long biography. Hiding from one place to another. One time, they put 10,000 dinar for his capture wanted, dead or alive. So he ran away from Kufa. He ran away from Kufa to Basra. His money ran out because of always running away. So he found a man, he said, can I work for you as a guard for your bustan, for your garden? And the garden was a garden of dates. And Basra was very famous with abundance of dates. While he was guarding, after a month or so, two passersby, Abir Sabil. In the Sunnah, if a Abir Sabil ask you for anything, you should give them, especially from a bustan, you could give them, but they're not allowed. For example, you tell them, go inside the bustan, eat whatever you want from my mangoes, from my dates, from my apples, but wallahi, I will take a little bit for my wife and my children. That's not allowed in the Sunnah. But eat as much as you want for yourself, no problem. So the two guys came and said, please, can we eat? He said, Ahla wa sahla, faddal, go eat. So he said, after they ate, he said, what do you think, ayyuha rajul? I want to ask you a question. What do you think is better, the dates of Basra or dates of Kufa? Now he is in Basra, remember. And he was born in Kufa, lived most of his life. He said, wallahi, the dates of Kufa are very good, but the dates of Basra, I never tasted them. You're a guard at the, يعني, the ones on the floor are more than the ones on the tree. You never tasted them? So one guy told the guy, he said, this guy is acting as if he's wari'a, and he has so much fear of Allah. He's acting up. So the other guy told him, he pretends to be Sufiyan Al-Thawri. He's acting like Sufiyan Al-Thawri. They never seen him because there was no pictures at the time. And all. So they hear about Sufiyan Al-Thawri's wara', but they never know who he is. So when Sufyan doubted this, he ran, because 10,000 dinar. So he ran away. He ran to Yemen. When he got to Yemen, something happened and the people over there accused him that he's a thief. Accused him that he stole something. So they took him to the Wali of Yemen. They said, this man is a thief. He said, هل سرقت? He said, لا والله. I did not steal anything. So he started repeating the question many times. He said, wallahi, I did not steal anything. So he told the guards and everybody, leave, I want to talk to him alone. He said, what's your name? He said, Abdullah ibn Abdul Rahman. Which is true. His name is Abdullah and his father's laqab is Abdul Rahman. Which is, we are all Abdullah. He said, seriously, what's your name? Because the man has a doubt. He said, Sufyan bin Abdullah. He said, no. When he pushed him, he said, Sufyan al-Thawri. He said, أنت Sufyan al-Thawri? قال نعم. قال أنت الحاكم. The Hakim is looking for you and everybody on earth is looking for you. He said, yes, that's me. He said, wallahi, if you are hiding under my feet, I will keep you hiding. Go wherever you want in Yemen. I will give you the security myself. So he went and he traveled. Now, another Khalifa came and he found out that his last destiny was in Mecca, and he gathered around some people and he started teaching them. So he sent al-Akhshabi, his name is called al-Akhshabi, to go and kill Sufyan al-Thawri because he keeps refusing. And so Sufyan al-Thawri, he said, I will come out in the open if I'm giving the guarantee of safety, and if the same guarantee is given to those who are being pursued because of me. Because of him, wherever he hid, those people who took him in, they were suffering. Their houses being, you know, destroyed, and just because they gave refuge to Sufyan. He said, I'm coming out. And he raised his hand and said, Ya Allah, take my soul before I get to them, before I get to the Khalifa. So Sufyan al-Thawri, on his way there, because khalas, he got very sick at the end of his life, and he was diagnosed with continuous diarrhea. They said that the last day of his life, he did wudu 60 times. 60 times. So before he got there, subhanallah, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that some people, their dua is never rejected. So he died before he get to the Khalifa. He, one of his very famous quotes is, he told once, his one of his students told, advise me, ya Imam, give me an advice. And this advice is for myself and for all my brothers and sisters. Work, listen carefully, Akhwan. Wallahi, if you leave this class with only this and you try to think about it and implement it in your life, it will be amazing, inshallah. He said, work for this dunya in proportion to the time you will stay in it. And work for the akhirah in proportion to the time you will stay in it. Very heavy. Work for this dunya, as long, how long are you going to stay in it? Very short period of time, so don't give it too much attention. And work for the akhirah, because you're going to stay for it for eternity, inshallah, in Jannah, bi-ithnillah. Work for it in the same proportion. Subhanallah. Sufyan, rahimahullah, he used to remember death abundantly, all the time. And he was seen crying most of the time. He said, the ulama said, we never see him in a majlis except he's crying, weeping hysterically. Now, what we learn from this seerah is that those giants in our history, they became in that level for a reason. For a reason. They put the akhirah in front of their eyes. And they did not fear anybody other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you imagine standing in front of the Khalifa and you tell him, and when he stood one time in front of the Mahdi, he said, لَقَدْ مَلَأْتَ الْأَرْضَ ظُلْمًا. You have filled the earth with ظُلْم. He said, what do you want from us? He said, go feed the awlad, the children of the muhajireen, of the ansar that's standing outside. Look at you. The Khalifa was in Mina, living, sitting in a pavilion with all kinds of luxury. He said, what is this? Sufyan al-Thawri walked in. He said, what is this? I remember Umar ibn al-Khattab. One time he came to Hajj, and after Hajj he asked his servants, how much did Hajj cost us this year? He said, 15 dinar. He said, Allahu Akbar, what is this luxury? What is this extravagance? 15 dinar. And look at you. You're sitting with this pavilion, all these guards around you, and you spend maybe thousands and thousands. This is the way he used to speak to the leaders. Subhanallah. He had no fear from nobody as long as it was the haqq. He was very famous for ordering good and forbidding evil. So inshallah ta'ala, if we learn something from Sufyan, it's his ordering good and forbidding evil. It's his fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his continuous crying and thinking of the akhirah. And on his deathbed, when he was dying, he told him, take me from my bed and put me on the ground and put my head on the dust. And put my head on the dust. And then they asked him, how are you feeling, ya Sufyan? He said, wallahi, I'm fearing of the evil end. Subhanallah. He has only a few minutes left of his life and he's fearing of su'ul khatima, of an evil end. Ya akhwan, where are we from Sufyan? And we feel like the Jannah is guaranteed in our pocket. So ya akhwan, let's not these stories become just bedtime stories or something. No, let's take something from them and learn it, inshallah ta'ala, and apply it in our life and teach it to our children. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the people who listen and apply. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me from the people who practice what they preach. Allahumma ja'alna mimman yastami'una al-qawla fayattabi'una ahsana. Jazakumullah khair.